Number 11 on my top 20 fancy mod list for medieval Total War Kingdoms. Total War, the Elder Scrolls, unofficial patch by, I believe, Jarly or something on moldb.com and Total War Center, etc. Jadley, probably. So this is a submod of the Elder Scrolls Total War. So the original mod was made by Russian modders, and this is a submod by Jadley over at Total War Center and moderbay.com and the Discord. Jadley is the name of the, I just didn't remember it in the beginning. So this is Elder Scrolls Total War, the latest release 2.0, but a submod for it. The difference is that we have the Septing campaign, with a bunch of different factions. This submod adds a bunch of new factions, using both new models and the skins of old models. It has a new menu, as we can see, not the same menu as the old one. It has a bunch of different campaigns. We have the Black Drake, we have the Three Banners War, Hardcore, and we have the Oblivion Cities, the Oblivion Crisis, which is also a Hardcore campaign. So both of these campaigns are very difficult. We have the Great War, we have the White Gold Concordat, we have the Stormcloak Rebellion, and we have the Fort Era. The original version 2.0 of the Elder Scrolls Total War, I believe, had only the Third Era and the Fort Era. Well, this submod adds a bunch of different eras, and the difference between the campaigns are probably explained in this menu here, the description, but I've read them in the past, and basically the Elder Scrolls Total War mod is based on the games, the Elder Scrolls. So for example, the Daggerfall game, the Morrowind game, the Skyrim game, and the Oblivion game, and different eras are different time periods. So for example, this Black Drake era is the first one, which takes place 2E 542, and then we have the second one here, Three Banners War, taking place in 2E 582. I believe 2E means second era, and then 542 is the year. So then we have the first one taking place in the second era at year 542, the second campaign taking place in the second era at the year 582. And then we have the third era at the year 533 in the third campaign, which is the Oblivion Crisis. Then we have the fourth era at the year 171, which is the Great War. And we have the fourth era at the year 575, just a few years later, which is the White Gold Concert. The White Gold Concordat. And then we have the fourth era at the year 201, which is the Stormcloak Rebellion, and then we have the fourth era campaign. I've just checked this mod out, I haven't really played it. I played a lot in the original release of the Elder Scrolls War in 2015, and I played it some in 2016, and I've also tried out all the releases, including this one, but I've only played the Battler, so I believe in 2016 and 2014, no, I believe 2015 and 2016. 2015 and 2016, I played some hot campaigns as everyone. Yeah. Okay, but this is a really ambitious submod by Jadley, adding numerous campaigns. In the original mod, there were only two campaigns, and the difference between the campaigns are that there are different alliances, different factions, different starting locations and such. The map is vastly different in different campaigns. You start one of the campaigns. We will start the Three Banners War, maybe. The Oblivion Crisis, maybe, but we can, I think we will try this one. And then we get the faction selection screen where we have a bunch of factions we can select, including four factions here. We have the Grace House Daggett, the Kingdom of Cyrodiil, the Council of Talmar, and the Great House Lalu. I believe the Council here is a new faction. The Kingdom of Cyrodiil is new as well. In the original mod you could only play as the Empire of Cyrodiil, but this is the Kingdom of Cyrodiil. Then we have Great House Dress, Great House Indoril, Tribes of Ashlanders, Great House Telvanni, Great House Redoran. We have Tribes of Black Marsh, Kingdom of Palatine. We have Kingdom of Anakinna, Kingdom of Valenwood, High Kingdom of Somerset Ayres. I believe they are the a Dominion faction later, but in this setting they are the High Kingdom of Somerset Ayres. So he has added a bunch of different factions based on the campaign. Maybe the same faction with a different name and earlier units in a different era. We have the Clan of Crowned, the Empire of Tamriel, the Hold of Hufingar, Hold of Hufingar actually, the Hold of Eastmarch. So the Nords have been divided into two factions in this campaign. We have the Clans of Orsamer, the Orcs, Kingdom of Sharnhelm, Kingdom of Daggerfall, and the Clan of Forebears, the Kingdom of Vayrest, and the Kingdom of Evermore. So there are a bunch of new factions. Most of them have reskins of other factions, of other factional units. Okay, we will start the campaign as we could take the Empire and just start it. So this mod is placed at number 11 because it's a submod. It has custom models. It has many custom strat map models for both generals, soldiers, agents, and cities. Not every city is custom. It has unique battlefields, unique trees, unique custom settlements in some places. But most of this stuff is from the official mod made by Russian modders, I believe. Two modders made a mod. It was Lord Nazgul and another guy. And Jad Lee made a submod based on their mod. And of course the submod will be ranked lower than the main mod because the submod, while adding many new factions to the mod and changing the map and adding many different campaigns with different map starting locations and different scripts and features, still is a submod. So in my opinion the main mod is deserving of a higher position on the list, and then this submod is based on it but adding a lot of new stuff. So it's still a really cool and good mod in its own right. So we have events such. Let's make the map visible. So we have the entire map visible now. This is just one of the eras. So the difference between the eras is that the map will look different when you start the campaign. This already looks very different compared to the official mod. Number of factions are vastly increased. We have new scripts, new events, new features, custom models, custom settlements in some places and such. It's a very, very good mod, very ambitious, and the only reason it's at place 11 is because it's not the original mod. And I didn't want both Elder Scrolls mod to be too high up, but I can tell you this one, that one of the Elder Scrolls mods are almost at the top. So, but this one is still place 11 on my list, and is a very, very ambitious submod of the Elder Scrolls lore, I highly recommend it. You should play it if you like Elder Scrolls, and you should also play it if you like fantasy mods and medieval too. And if you want a different setting than the 3rd and 4th eras in this setting, then you have no choice but to play this one, because this one adds the 2nd era and many more campaigns set in the 4th era. While the original mod only had the 3rd era and the 4th era and only 2 campaigns. And this mod adds many more features and scripts. I believe there are dungeons in this mod placed out on the map. When you take a dungeon, for example, you get certain resources. The original mod doesn't have that feature because Lord Nazgul and the other developer said that they didn't like the idea of making the main mod a role-playing experience. They wanted it to be strictly strategy. So, but Yadli wanted some roleplay in the game. I mean, the original mods are roleplaying games. So he thought it would be fun with some dungeons. If you conquer them, you get rewards. You should only conquer them when you get missions to take them. Yeah, but anyway, it has a really, really cool map. It's the same map as in the original game, but now with many more factions placed out and dungeons, new events, new scripts and such. And I highly recommend it, and I placed it on the 11th position. It could have probably been placed higher, because it's a really, really good mod. It has all of these factions in custom battle. If you look at the rosters, they are completely custom. Only the siege engines are vanilla. The crews are custom, of course. And yeah, it's really impressive, and probably could be seen as better than the original mod if you like the other eras and if you want more factions and such. I might have some hypocrisy here, because I said I would place the original mod above this one, but at the same time I placed the Hyrule Total War 4.6 mod beneath the submod that I had made. But that's because the submod of Hyrule Total War is way more polished and more completed, with more features than the recent version 4.6. While this mod, it's different from the official version of Elder Scrolls and adds certain things that the official version doesn't have, but it's still not more polished. I believe the official mod is still extremely polished. It has other features that this one either don't have or that makes it somewhat different. I believe the official version of Elder Scrolls Total War has different goals in mind than this version. They are like two different versions of the same mod. Both are equally polished and equally impressive, and you shouldn't play one over the other. And the only reason this is a place that place 11 is because I didn't want two Elder Scrolls mod at the very top. But I placed the other one almost at the top, so this one could as well have been there. And the only reason it is on place 11 is because the other one is even higher up. But it could have been this one at the other place, and the other one on place 11 too. But I felt the submod is less popular on mod B than the other one. The other one is always at the top 3, while this one is not as high up in the rankings. So that's why this one is at place 11, while the other one is actually very high up. Okay, and we can see the models are good and everything. So the number 11th mod is the unofficial patch for the Elder Scrolls Total War by Yadli. Okay, next one. Number 10, DCI, The Last Alliance. A submod for the Third Age Total War, set in the Second Age. So this is a very, very good submod, which adds a lot of new units to every faction. I believe all the units are new in this mod. They are not using the old models of Third Age Total War. They have added new ones. it's set on the same map as the old traditional war, Divide and Conquer and such, because it's a submod just like Divide and Conquer, but it has fewer factions than Divide and Conquer, but still more factions than the original traditional war. I believe traditional war had 12 factions, and this mod has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Factions, so at least one more faction compared to the old traditional war. And then instead of the old factions, we have the Kingdom of Lindon, led by High King Gil-galad, and we have the Numenorean kingdoms, led by High King Elendil, the father of Isildur, I believe. And we have the Rovanian faction, led by King Fritigern. We have the Kingdom of Khazad-dûm, led by King Durin IV. We have Lothlorien, led by King Amdir. But I believe Galadriel has her own model in this mod, unlike in Traditional War and Divide and Conquer. So she is one of the leaders in this faction. She is the queen of I believe the leader in Divide and Conquer, not King Amdir. Maybe she's the daughter or something. His daughter or something. I don't know, except to be honest. But this is Lothlorien. And we have Eren Galen, the Sylvan Elves, led by King Orofer. And by the way, the Galadriel model is really good. Looks like the actress. And then we have Men of the Mountains, those that were cursed into the undead that Aragorn had to free, because they had broken their oath years ago. So this is before they broke their oath to the Numenorean kings. Okay, Men of the Mountains, we have Mordor, led by Sauron here as well. We have Wildmen of Nidwaith, led by Halvar Mogru. And we have Orcs of the Misty Mountains, led by High Chieftain Gorgol. We have Hillmen of the North, led by Warlord Rasa. We have Harad, led by King Harimor and King Fëanor. And we have the Rune Confederacy, led by Warlord Bortrand. And this mod is set in the Second Age, as I said. In the prologue to the Lord of the Rings movie, you see a scene from the final scene of the Second Age, where armies of the humans and the elves are fighting on the slopes of Mount Doom against the armies of Mordor, and where the father of Isildur is killed, and Isildur picks up his father's sword and cuts the ring, the finger with the ring out. I believe he cuts the ring finger off Sauron's hand. All that is from the Second Age, and it's actually the end scenes of this age. I believe this mod starts earlier and is about that period. So you play basically until you reach that climax. And this mod has a lot of cool new units. It has custom cities, it has new events, new scripts and such. Let's start the faction. We can start as Lothlorien. There's new loading screens too. Real actors. You can see that we get a welcome message when we start up the mod. Then we get an option here. We'll just click on accept. We get some info. There are a lot of event text like that showing up during different turns. We have different gameplay features, scripts that will activate, and even like scripted events like alliances between the good factions and, you know, alliances between the evil factions. Let's show the map. There are ants and the spiders in this game too. So here we have regent am there. They also have Galadriel. Artanis Galadriel is her full name. She's a general here. Looks like the actor. It's her own unique model on both the map and in battle. I actually played this campaign as the Galadriel using the immersion mode or third person mode, playing as Galadriel for the most part, and I played for over 50 turns. I believe, yeah. November 10th, 2020. So I played for over a year ago now. Played for a few hours. Wanted to try it out. It's very impressive. The custom settlements are really good looking. And the models are great. Much better than vanilla 3rd Age. And new and fresh. So it won't feel old. And I like that they have a Galadriel playable. It was epic to play her in 3rd person. We have the same map as in other 3rd Age mods. A huge map of Middle Earth. And with the 2nd Age setting, this mod is unique, unlike Divide and Conquer and 3rd Age and 3rd Age 4.0, which are all set in the same setting, as are many other mods for 3rd Age. I believe Reforged had a different approach, where they had like sandbox campaign, where they didn't even follow any book or movie. This one tries to follow the lore of the 2nd Age, unlike most other mods which are trying to follow the lore of the 3rd Age setting, where the movies are based on, which the movies are based on. Okay, then there is a Silmarillion mod, by the way, that I had planned on having on this list, but I couldn't start it up for some reason, so I cut it from the list. Okay, Silmarillion mod with a campaign. Okay, but this mod has a campaign that is very, very well made. This mod was also under development for many years. And they had that attitude that they needed to be very, very polished before they want to release it. They finally released it in 2020. I played it once in November 2020 and it was really good. I also watched a guy, Issy, I believe, on YouTube. Play a Galadriel campaign on his YouTube channel in 2020. But this game is just like 3rd Age, but with new models, same map, new factions, a new setting, new scripts, new events, new heroes. And I highly recommend it if you want to play a campaign and you like fantasy and you like Lord of the Rings and you like Medieval 2. And if you don't want to play the 3rd Age, then why not play the 2nd Age? I place it at number 10 on my list because it's really good. This starts to be in the top 10. Of course, we have a bunch of other 3rd Age mods on the top 20 list as well. And I don't want too many 3rd Age mods at top. But this one could have very well been higher up on the list. I just decided to not have every mod be 3rd Age Total War at the top. But this is clearly one of the best fantasy mods for Medieval 2 Total War. And I plan on playing a campaign as the Galadriel later on my YouTube channel. I used to have too many campaigns going on at this time. But when I finally decide to play this, I will play the Galadriel. And I can already say that this is one of the best fantasy mods for Medieval 2. One of the most polished mods for sure. And I highly recommend it, and it's the number 10 on my top 20 list. That means it will also be number 10 on a top 10 list of fantasy mods. Of course, on my top 20 list of mods from Medieval 2, it might not make it, or it might make it. We will see. I believe it will probably make it in the top 20 list for mods over Medieval 2 Total War. I believe if it's the number 10th mod, then it will make top 20, because I will have the top 10 fantasy mods be like in a competition with the top 10 historical mods. So this will certainly be in that competition too, but I don't know exactly where it will end up. But this mod is the number 10 on my top 20 fantasy list for Medieval Total War Kingdoms. And you should clearly check it out. Let's go back to the menu. Go to custom battles. You can see that they have all these factions. When you check the models, you can see that they are new. Some models are probably shared with Third Age, like this one probably, but most of them are completely new and fresh. You check the Galadrim, for example, the Lorien. You see that the early troops are not very impressive. They still look different compared to the old models. Then the new models, they are really cool. The elite models. So yeah, the models are clearly better. If you look at Mordor, see that they have werewolves, a new model. They have spiders. They have a bunch of different orcs that weren't in the old version. But the trolls look like they are similar to the old ones. Maybe they are still new, but similar. All the orcs and goblins have been replaced. Very good. I'm so tired of the old Mordor units. Okay, if you click on quick battle, you can take a look at some troops in battle as well. This is a beta version, the public beta of DCI The Last Alliance. I believe the only official beta that has been released. They haven't released any update yet. Start deployment. You can see this unit. Bulldog Wardens of Mordor. Completely unique model. Never seen it before. The face is great. They look very unique. Very, very orcish. I like the model. Really cool. Here we have a goblin unit, seems to be based on the old ones, but with some unique textures and such. We have some orcs here, completely a new unit, never seen it before. Same with this one, the orc band, has a completely fresh unit model. We have the mountain trolls, they are new, similar to the old ones, but new. We have the Gorgoroth archers, very new and recent unit model, never seen it before, much better face than the old one from Third Age. Third Age models are outdated in my opinion. Battalion of the Eye, really cool elite unit. We have some more models here. So this is the Mordor faction in DCI Last Alliance. Much better looking orcs than in the original game, or mod I mean. Here we have a different faction. Ents, the Ents are a faction. And this model looks pretty cool, Uorns. I believe they are inspired by the Warhammer models. I don't really like these Uorns. I think Uorns should be trees and not dryads or whatever they are. We have Ents too, much better Ents in this version that look better than the old ones and work better too. But the Uorns are not really what you would expect. I would expect them to be more like the Deku trees in Hyrule Total War Classic Ultimate. Trees that move pretty much, and not dryads like in Warhammer. But the Ents, they are great looking. I have to give them credit for the new Ents. Okay, so we've seen some of the models. We can see that the models are vastly superior to the ones in the old Third Age mod. And the mod is a very impressive mod, and I place it at number 10 on my list. But it could very well have been higher up if I didn't put it lower, just because I didn't want all the top mods to be Third Age to the war and its submods. You know, it's obvious which mod will be the number one mod. I don't want all the top 5 mods to be Third Age, but this mod could have been higher up on the list. Okay, so it's top 10. We will continue with the next one. Number 9, Game of Thrones to lore enhanced. So the background video is not working currently, but that's good right now because, you know, it might be copyright struck. It's just using scenes from the TV show after all. Okay, so this is a submod of Westeros to lore, the alpha 0.53 or 0.54, released in 2011. So this submod originally was released in 2011 and added art, new scripts, a new UI, new sound and other stuff. But the models only first arrived in 2016. We can check the campaign. So we have a bunch of different factions here. You can play as House Stark, led by Robb Stark. You can play as House Bolton, led by Roose Bolton. You can play as House Greyjoy, led by Balon Greyjoy. You can play as House Arryn, led by Robin Arryn. You can play as House Tully, led by Edmure Tully. We can play as House Lannister, led by Tywin Lannister. We can play as Baratheon of King's Landing, led by Joffrey Baratheon. We can play as Baratheon of Dragonstone, led by Stannis Baratheon. And we can play as Baratheon of Storm's End, led by Renly Baratheon. We can play as House Tyrell, led by Mance Tyrell. And we can play as House Martell, led by Doran Martell. And all of these factions are the same factions as in the official Westeros mod, with the exception of House Bolton, which was a new faction we added in 2016. And House Frey, of course, is new, led by Valder Frey, that I added during the spring of 2017. So House Bolton and House Frey have still been in the mod since 2016 or 2017. Then in custom battles, I believe I added House Targaryen, the Night's Watch, the Wildlings, also known as the Free Folk, to custom battles, but they weren't actually playable in the campaign because the map was very small in earlier versions of the mod. But now they've been added to the campaigns. We can play as Targaryen, led by Viserys Targaryen. They will get Daenerys later in the game, because she spawns on a dragon, she's riding a dragon in the mod, she's overpowered. So we wanted her in the late game. Fuck, I forgot to close down Discord, I believe. We have the Night's Watch, led by Georg Mormont, father of Jorah Mormont, by the way. We have the Wildlings, led by Mance Rayder, the King Beyond the Wall. Then we have two new factions for this version of the mod, the Free Cities of Essos and the others, led by the Night King. But these three were also new for the campaign in this version. So this version of the mod was released in May 2021. First they released it in February, on February 21st, 2021. Then I released the fix, I believe, in early March, and then later an update in May. There is another update in the works, but it's not finished, so I'm not gonna preview that one. That version will add updated hero models. All of them will have shields, or most of them. In this version they do not have shields. And also, I believe we fixed a few issues in the game. We added a few new models to the Lannisters and some others. And they might get some more strat model variations too. Okay, so this mod was originally based on the alpha of Westeros to lore, and I downloaded this mod to play it already back in 2013, I believe. It was originally developed by Inarus over at the Lore Center and his team. Back then it was an art mod that turned Westeros to lore into a mod with the art and user interface being like the TV show, and changed most of the portraits and the music and the voices, etc., to that of the TV show. But it still had the same vanilla models with their skins. In 2016, a user named Vilti Maratio started creating models for this version of Westeros to the War, known as Game of Thrones Enhanced. And he asked for people to help him, and I joined him, and after that we released a bunch of different versions of Game of Thrones Enhanced, a submod of Westeros to the War, which is standalone and doesn't require Westeros to the War to be played. And in the final versions of this mod, I believe Viltima stopped working on the... Fuck. So I'll be right back. I've closed down the Discord server. It was annoying. There was people were writing all the time in other servers that I am not even involved in. But I'm following because I am a member of many servers. Okay. But anyway, I believe the latest version was worked on by Firestorm and me. Mostly Firestorm, and Vilti Maratio stopped working on Game of Thrones Enhanced already after 2017, I believe. But he did some models in during the summer of 2019, where he did the Golden Company, I believe. But anyway, so this is a submod original of Westeros to the War, but it has models based on the TV show, and in the latest version, which we released this year, during February, March and May, we added a completely new map made by Soul Games Inkle, that he originally developed for his project, but in the end, that project was cancelled, and I got permission to use the map in this project instead. So we have his map, and it's way bigger than the original map. We'll take a look at it immediately. Can start the mod as the Wildlings. Oh, it crashed. I don't know why. Never happened before. But I haven't started this mod since I fixed Steam. I will need to restart the game. Okay. Right, I'm back, so I had to restart the game. For some reason it started to crash all the time when I tried to launch a campaign immediately. So on this version you're not supposed to need to play a quick battle before starting the game, but when I played a quick battle and then went to the campaign selection screen and then started the campaign, it worked. So I needed to play a quick battle. Usually that will happen when you have added a bunch of strat models. At some point or another, the game will start demanding that you play a quick battle or custom battle before you start the campaign. We have that issue in Warcraft of War, and I had it in the old Game of Thrones Enhanced too. But it shouldn't be in this version, so I'm very surprised that it returned. But anyway, I managed to enter the campaign. Let's use Toggle Fav. So we can see that we have a huge map made by Soul Games Inkle, and it's a really impressive map. The models and architecture and everything is based on the show instead of the books, and this is an old mod, originally developed already back in 2011, and I downloaded it back in 2013 and played the version that was available back then when it had vanilla models, back when Innerus was developing it. And as I said, me and Vilti Maratio started to cooperate. He made models and I coded gameplay and models into the game. He also coded some models into the game, and I added new animations from Warhammer and such, and, you know, but a lot of stuff have happened since then. That was back in 2016 and 17. Then in 2019, I believe, Firestorm and I started to cooperate, and we released a new version this year, and it had this new huge map, which allowed us to add the Night's Watch to the campaign, and we also added the others, and we added Three Cities of Essos, and we added House Targaryen also in 2020, I believe. We got over 72 new hero models based on the characters from the show. And we have added a bunch of new units and added gameplay and such. So this mod is really good, and it's highly recommended if you like fantasy mods, you like medieval Total War, and you like Game of Thrones or Westeros. It's set during the time of the TV show and has models that aim to look like in the TV show as well. Compared to Fire and Blood, it has a different map, because the Fire and Blood map was based on Westeros 1.0's map, and this map is different. They are very similar, but this map has Westeros and parts of Essos, while the Westeros 1.0 map used in Westeros 1.0 only had Westeros, but Peeman's version of it has all of Essos, because he added that. Well, this map only has a little part of Essos, but has more areas in Westeros instead. But we are not using all 199 regions. I believe Solgame Single used all. I have a version with all of them, but that's less finished than this one. I believe it doesn't have the others, and it doesn't have the three cities of Essos, and it doesn't have any of the scripts for the Targaryens or the Wildlings. We use scripts to spawn the dragons and later heroes, and giants and mammoths, so they won't be too many. If you recruit them like ordinary units, they would be spammed by the AI and would be too many and too strong. By spawning them through scripts, they will be limited in numbers and they will be weaker. Well, at the same time, they will show up only in the late game, so it won't be OP for the other factions. Okay, but anyway, I highly recommend this mod. I've done a lot of work on it myself, and out of all the Game of Thrones mods, this mod is one of the most popular mods. Might be the most popular mod, or the second most popular mod, but I think it's actually the most popular mod. It's more popular than Westeros 1.0, and I believe the reason is because it has the style of the TV show. People prefer that over the style of the books, and it's also, in my opinion, more stable. But some people may disagree. And then Fire and Blood has similar models, but Peeman is remaking the models, so they look different in his recent version, I believe. But in earlier versions we had the same models, because he also got permission to use the same models, but they were in use in this mod first. And then the heroes, we have about the same number of heroes with the same heads, but the bodies are different, because we decided to use the models by Will Timoratio for the bodies, while he decided to keep them as they were in the German mod, the 30 models that were in the German mod. And then because I believe the German mod had stolen the models from the Seven Kingdoms mod for Attila, then we took them from there. It was 30 models, I believe, and then we got permission from the creator, unlike the German mod, to use them. But then Peeman rigged about 40 additional models, and the creator of the models demanded that the Game of Thrones fans would be allowed to use them too. That's why we got them from Peeman. But his models kept, in many cases, the bodies of the German mod, and also the new models might have some different bodies too. I believe Firestorm also remade some of them a little bit to be different from the Fire and Blood mod's models. So we have the same heroes, but with different bodies for some of them, and different details like hair and such. But when it comes to armies, they used to be exactly the same, but in his latest version, I believe he has remade certain rosters, so they are not the same anymore. But at the core, they are both based on Will Timoratio's models. Even though Fire and Blood, I believe, also had models from Westeros 1.0 that are pretty good. But anyway, this mod is highly recommended. Unlike the old versions, it has a huge map that was added for the first time this year, and more factions on the map, and yeah, it's a great mod. If you like Westeros and Game of Thrones, you should try it. And even if you haven't read the books or watched the TV show, if you like fantasy and medieval too, you should try it. Let's check custom battle. and all Starks and Boltons can see that there are a lot of heroes in custom battle. Unlike Fire and Blood, we have all the heroes in custom battle and in the campaign. Fire and Blood only have them in the campaign, I believe. And another difference is that our Wildling faction has way more troops. This is because we didn't have 500 units. We had room for this faction when Firestorm made it. He made a lot of variations, while Fire and Blood had already filled its rosters. I believe there is a limit of 500 units in any medieval Total War mod, and we haven't reached it yet, while Fire and Blood has reached the limit. So P-Man has a lot of minor house factions with units, and therefore he didn't have room for the Wildlings. He had 5 old units and the heroes. So he has the heroes, and he has 5 old units, including Giants and Mammoths, but and he has better Giants and Mammoths that look like the ones from the show, because he rigged the units himself. He has the same infantry, but only 5 out of these units, because the rest, he had no room for them when Firestorm offered him the units. Then he went to me and offered them instead. And I said yes. Okay, so we have all of these factions in custom battle. And let's click on quick battle. We also have loading screen space on the show. But they are probably very much similar to older versions of Fire and Blood, maybe not the recent version. We look at the models, we can see that they are great quality. The show style. The Unsullied. And Dothraki. Targaryen troops. We have certain Berstan Selmy here. The custom model, very very good model. In my opinion, it looks very good. Start the battle. Here we have Starks with their own troops, including a hero here. Probably minor general, minor hero. I don't know his name. Here's another one. Don't really remember the names of the minor characters. But he is a custom character. Okay, so yeah, this is the number 9th mod on my list for the top 20 fantasy mods for Medieval Total War Kingdoms, Game of Thrones Total War Enhanced. By the way, it also has custom settlements from Westeros 1.0 for the, I believe, all the castles at the wall. Is using the same. And then we have Dragonstone, we have King's Landing, and we have Moat Cailin. And then also we have Reskin of Highgarden, I believe. And Sunspear might be different from a vanilla model too. Okay, and that's it. So this was number 9. The reason I rank Game of Thrones Total War Fire and Blood higher today than this mod, despite this being the one I worked on, is because P-Man has done a lot of work on custom settlements, in other words, custom cities. And with 2 cities, I think his mod is the better one. But this one has a different focus. I believe Fire and Blood has 16 different campaigns, while this mod only has the War of the Five King campaign. War of the Five Kings campaign. So if you want only one setting, you should play this mod, and if you want many, you should play his mod. If you want to play the Wildlings, you should play this mod, and also if you like Daenerys to ride dragons, you should play this mod. She rides a horse in his version. And also this mod has different gameplay compared to Fire and Blood and a different map. But his mod has like a vast number of custom settlements, including Winterfell and Heron Hall and the Dreadfort and such. So in my opinion, his mod is the more impressive today because of the settlement. And also he has a lot of cool strat model cities too everywhere, and unique models, I mean, and a lot of strat models for the generals and such. I think he has done more of he's done more work on details, I believe, when it comes to models. While this mod may still be the more completed when it comes to one campaign. I believe our campaign is more feature filled and maybe less unstable. But also, if you want to play with all of Westeros, you know, both Westeros and Essos, then you should play his mod. But this mod, certainly, you should play this one if you want the War of the Five Kings to be the focus. Okay, and I kind of have a bias towards this mod because I worked on this mod. But the custom settlements in his mod, I have to say, must land his mod a higher position. But I still think this mod is ranked higher on modable.com. It's more popular for some reason. Okay, but that's the pricing. I believe the custom cities of Fire and Blood makes that mod the mod with the more impressive mod. Okay, and the more immersive mod. Okay, but because this mod is still using a bunch of vanilla settlements. But his mod is still using vanilla settlements in some places too. It's just that he has maybe 30 or 40 different custom settlements, while we only have like 4 different custom settlements, or 5. Okay, so number 9, Game of Thrones Total War Enhanced.